Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today I will open up a chapter on how to stay anonymous. So there are several ways, several methods that you can use. First off, you've probably heard about these things. They are proxies. So you are just routing your connection through several different points, although this can be very slow depending on the speed of the proxies elsewhere. And you also know nothing of the other side. You know nothing of the servers through which your packets are going. So that can be risky, but then again, if you're using nmap to footprint a network, why do you care? It's not of importance. However, if you're using proxies to log in somewhere or pass credentials or something of a kind, that is potentially dangerous and you should not do that. I mean, it's quite literally you shouldn't do it. The other option is to use some sort of VPNs and to encrypt your networks, to encrypt your traffic between you and the VPN service provider. Now these things can be very fast depending on which one you have, so you can just pay for a service out there. I think a yearly subscription is like 100 and something bucks. A monthly subscription is like 10 bucks, something like that. You get a dedicated VPN static IP address. So you can do a lot of stuff, and they can be very, very, very fast. Furthermore, your traffic is encrypted, as I said, and the only way that somebody can figure out that you are doing something somewhere is if the VPN service provider actually relinquishes your information. However, this does not happen that often. This is very difficult to attain, especially if you get a VPN some in certain parts of the world where they just generally don't give these sort of information out. But I wouldn't recommend doing that for white hat hacking, primarily because there isn't a need to stay anonymous to that extent. What we are going to be using VPNs and proxies mainly for, or what they are mainly used for in the world today, I would say anyway, this is just my personal opinion, is to bypass firewall settings or firewall limitations, should I say. So here's a real life example that people have been using quite often, that people are using pretty much on a daily basis. Netflix, for example, has a certain range of IP addresses from which it allows connections. So if you are elsewhere in the world and you do not belong to that IP address range, it will not allow you to view anything on the site. It will not allow you to see movies or something of a kind. However, if you use a proxy, a good one, or if you use a VPN, you will be able to access the site as though you were coming from the country which falls within the IP address range list. So that's just one of the common examples of what people are doing. Not exactly legal, but, oh well, people have been doing it. It's not exactly harmful or something like that. You're not taking servers down or anything of a kind, but people have been using it in order to be able to watch Netflix from, I don't know, a cell phone when they're traveling or something like that. In any case, there are numerous other examples. When you want to bypass certain firewall settings, primarily you bypass the IP range lists which are allowed to access a certain server or something like that, but also, for example, if you have a certain server whose traffic is mainly generated from a single area, from a single country, and you do not want to be, for example, scanning it from, I don't know, an IP address that belongs to the area in China or something like that, because those IP addresses, they look very differently. I mean, of course, they're written the same, but any network administrator, as soon as they see that IP address of that kind, that is far away from their geographical area, they will know that it's an anomaly of some sort and that it doesn't belong there, and they will be intrigued, they will start looking. So that is not something you want happening to you. You want to be accessing the server from where all the other users are accessing it from, in order to hide yourself in the mass. In any case, that is what we shall be doing in this chapter and a few other things, but for the time being, for this tutorial, I want to show you how you can actually access the dark web or the hidden web, whichever way you wish to refer to it. Now, the rumor is that the dark web is a lot bigger than your regular internet, that there's a lot more information there, And I use its resources. A lot of people do. There are some very nice forums where you can get a lot of good stuff. So I would definitely recommend trying it out, and you will, at some point of time, you will need it. For that, you will need to install a Tor browser, and with a Tor browser, you will be able to access darknet. Now, it is not installed by default on Kali, and we do, this is one of those rare occasions and rare situations where we will actually need a different user other than root in order to be able to do anything with Tor, in order to be able to start it. So first off, I'm going to go ahead and create a new user. So just open up your virtual machine. You see mine is already opened up here. I'm just changing the size so that you can see that it's a virtual machine. And I have my terminal up and running here. I can close it and reopen it. There you go. Just open up your regular terminal and type in the following. So first off, we need Tor. I will explain what Tor is in a moment, but you just type in apt-get space install Tor space dash y and press enter. With this command that I am highlighting at the moment, Tor will install no problems on Kali as long as you have an active internet connection. It is not installing here because I already have it installed. The following fact, right? Yep, there we go. It says Tor is already the newest version. So it is already installed. It is the newest version. I have deliberately skipped all the verbose installation, the entire verbose installation mode, primarily because you're not going to see anything useful there at the moment, and it's going to waste quite a bit of time. So just type in this command. You will not be prompted for any questions because of the dash y argument, and the installation will go through no problems. Let me just go ahead and clear the screen. Now the next thing that we need to do is actually create that user that we have, that I have been talking about. So just go ahead and type in the command add user, just a keynote here. There is also a command user add. Do not use this command for the time being, primarily because I have discovered that it causes some unnecessary complications which tend to hinder us along the way. So just go ahead and type in add user space, and now you can name your user whatever you want. You cannot use capital letters, if I remember correctly. That's the rule in Debian systems. So I'm just going to call my user random. I'm not going to call him random. I'm going to call him, how shall I call him? I'll call him test. Here, my user will be test. And there we go. Now it says adding user test, adding new group test, adding new user test with group test. That's pretty much what has happened here. It has created a home directory for that user. It already exists. What do you know? I have created it previously, but I have deleted it just to make sure that there are no mistakes in this tutorial. But it doesn't matter. If it it will say here that the home test directory has been created and that you will be able to use it. You do need this folder primarily because we're going to be doing stuff there which you cannot do with root. I'll go ahead and type in your password here. It doesn't show anything when you type. That's the standard way of Unix passwords in order to prevent anybody from seeing the length of your password on the screen. Very nice. So press enter. Now you are prompted here for some username information, for some information in regards to that user, completely irrelevant for our purpose today. So we do not want to type in the full name, room number, work phone, home phone, other, don't care. Is this information correct? Sure, why not? Press enter, and there we go. We have just effectively created our new user test, to which we need to log and then from there conduct our work. Now, a key thing to note here is that even though there is a way of configuring the Tor browser to run as root, it's not simple, but there is a way, do not do that. I mean, do not, primarily, it's not even a good idea to browse the internet as a root user. You can, if you pick any sort of viruses up, any sort of malicious code, it's going to run as root. So you don't want that on your system. You do not want to compromise it in such a way. And generally, on the machine that you are performing these attacks, like this virtual machine of Kali Linux, you don't really use it to browse the internet. For the sake of examples, I sometimes open the browser Firefox, basically IceWeasel, and do some stuff there just to show you the information. Or I, as you've seen now, I have downloaded specific from a very specific site. Actually, not now, but in a few moments you will. I will download from a very specific site a Tor browser. So just when you know exactly what you're doing and where you are getting it from, and when you have verification of the source, then you should use it as root, or you can use it as root, but otherwise do not browse the internet as a root user. That's a bad idea. However, we will only use this user, well, maybe not only, but mainly for our Tor browser. Otherwise, we will be using the root user primarily, because you can't do pretty much anything in Kali without the root user. All the tools more or less require these sort of root permissions, as they do tend to access network related things. Anyway, I will cut the tutorial here, and I'll see you in the second part of it.